Let's discuss example two of resonant inverters. So we have a half bridge resonant inverter with bidirectional switches. There's the circuit right here, the one that we discussed earlier. Switching frequency 3.5 kilohertz. That is, switching frequency is pretty much the same as the output frequency, because when, let's say, Q1 is going to turn on and then it's going to turn off, the next time Q1 is going to turn on, that's the switching frequency, and that will be the frequency of one pulse of the output. So in this case, switching frequency and output frequency is the same thing. C1 and C2 are equal, 3 microfarad, inductor is 50 microhenry, and resistor is 2 ohm. Okay, so one thing that you need to observe, because we have to calculate alpha, omega naught, and omega n, and remember to calculate alpha and omega naught, they correspond to the natural circuit, the source-free circuit, so we have to shut down the sources. Again, go back to circuit analysis. So when we turn the source off, Vs goes to zero, short circuit, then you will see that C1 will be connected between this node and ground, or not ground, just basically a short, and C2 will be connected this node and the short. That means both capacitor 1 and capacitor 2 will be connected between this node right here and the short circuit, which will be in place of Vs when you are making this circuit a source-free circuit, natural circuit. So C1 and C2 will appear to be in parallel with each other. So when we are solving for alpha, omega naught, and omega n, we need to keep the equivalent capacitor. That is because they correspond to the natural circuit. So they are in parallel with each other. So when capacitors are in parallel with each other, of course, we add those values together. So the equivalent capacitor value is going to be 6 microfarad. We calculate resonant frequency of the RLC circuit, square root of 1 over LC equivalent. This is the resonant frequency. Calculate A, alpha, your Knapper frequency, and calculate the natural resonant frequency. These values are the same pretty much as example 1, because again, we are taking the same values. The value of C equivalent is the same as value of C in example number 1. So we are going to calculate the capacitor voltage, VC. And VC is, because in the first one we have to calculate output current expression and waveform. So VC from, again, go back to what we have discussed in the first part of inverters. VC is the voltage which is given by this expression. And it came out to be 100.443 as it was in example 1. And I'm just using a variable A, which is the peak value of, or not the peak value, but that's the constant associated with the current expression, which is Vs plus Vc over omega nL. So 118.331. So the current is 118.331 e to the power negative alpha t, which is negative 20,000 sine omega nt. And this is valid from 0 to t1. And again, t1 is 58 microsecond as it was in the first one. Now total output period is 1 over switching frequency, so 285.7143 microsecond. Now observe that we have 4 pulses, remember, Q1 on, D1 on, Q2 on, and D2 on, or right here. And it's a non-overlapping operation. So the total amount of time over which those pulses are going to be there is 4 times T1, 232 microsecond. Now the output time period is 285 microsecond. So that means 285 minus 232, that is the time when there is no pulse at the output. That means that's the dead zone, or when all the switches are off, both the switches are off, and there is no current flowing through D1 and D2 either. So 53.69 microsecond is when both the switches are off. That means each dead zone is 26.8461 microsecond. You have two dead zones. You have this dead zone, as you can see in the diagram, and you have this dead zone. So after D1 and after D2. peak load current will happen at the peak time. Again, we find the peak load current here. It's exactly similar way like we did in the first one, first example. Output RMS current, now this is the output. So RMS current, I'm going to calculate the area under curve for this pulse only over T1, because rest of the pulses, again, when I will square them, they will become exactly the same as this. So area of each pulse squared is going to be exactly the same. So I'm just going to calculate the area under curve for one pulse, a square of one pulse, which is this, and then multiply that by 4, divide by T out, that's the average value, and then square root is going to give me the root mean squared value. So I'm going to use again MATLAB or Octave to do that as I did in example number 1, and the RMS value is going to be 44.096. Okay, I'm not doing this, but I want you to finish this. Calculate the average and RMS value of the Q1 current. Remember, which current is the Q1 current? When Q1 is on. So this is the current of Q1. There will be no current except this current passing through Q1, and then it's going to be zero until the next time Q1 will be on. So calculate the RMS and average value of the Q1 current and the average output power. Remember, the average output power, as we calculated in the first example, is the RMS current squared times the resistor value. So make sure you do that.